Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
On today's program, we tell you about the latest recipients of the Nobel Prize in Physics. Later, Mario Ritter Jr. and Katie Weaver present this week's Education Report. We close the show with the lesson of the day. But first, two early developers of artificial intelligence have won this year's Nobel Prize in Physics. American John Hopfield is with Princeton University in New Jersey. Jeffrey Hinton is a citizen of Canada and Britain who works at the University of Toronto. The Royal Swedish Academy of Sciences honored them for helping to develop methods that are the foundation of today's powerful machine learning. The 76-year-old Hinton is known as the godfather of artificial intelligence for his part in developing machine learning. However, he also has warned that AI has created threats to humanity. Ellen Moons is a member of the Nobel Committee at the Royal Swedish Academy of Sciences. Moons said the two scientists used fundamental concepts from statistical physics to design artificial neural networks that function as associative memories and find patterns in large data sets. Moons added that their research has been used to make progress in physics, but has also become part of people's daily lives. Technologies like facial recognition and language translation are used every day. Hinton predicted that AI would have a huge influence on civilization and will bring improvements to productivity and healthcare. He told reporters and Royal Academy officials that it would be comparable to the Industrial Revolution. The Industrial Revolution was a period of intensive development of machines and manufacturing that started more than 250 years ago in Britain. Hinton said, "Instead of exceeding people in physical strength, it's going to exceed people in intellectual ability." But Hinton also expressed concern about the possible bad results of AI, especially noting, in his words, the threat of these things getting out of control. The Nobel Committee also recognized the possible damage the discoveries that it was honoring could cause. Moons said AI's development has also raised concerns about our future. Collectively, humans carry the responsibility for using this new technology in a safe and ethical way for the greatest benefit of humankind. In the 1980s, Hinton helped to develop a method known as backpropagation, which is used to train computers to learn. Later, he headed a team at the University of Toronto that won the ImageNet computer competition in 2012 for designing a neural network. Hinton and AI scientists Joshua Bengio and Jan LeCun won the Turing Award in 2019. It is the top award in computer science. That year, Hinton told the Associated Press about the reaction he and his fellow researchers received over their work. "They thought we were very misguided and what we were doing was a very surprising thing for apparently intelligent people to waste their time on. My message to young researchers is, don't be put off if everyone tells you what you are doing is silly. Hopfield is now 91 years old. The Nobel Committee said he invented a network that uses a method for saving and recreating patterns. Hinton used Hopfield's network to create a new network using a different method known as the Boltzmann machine. The committee said this machine can learn to recognize elements in a particular kind of data. What fascinates me most is still this question of how mind comes from machine, Hopfield said in a video posted online by the Franklin Institute after it awarded him a physics prize in 2019. The Nobel Prize in Physics is valued at $1 million. Swedish inventor Alfred Nobel created the prizes to honor discoveries that help humanity. The first prizes were awarded in 1901. On Wednesday, the prize in chemistry will be announced. On Thursday, the prize for literature. And Friday, the Peace Prize. The Nobel for Economics will be announced on Monday. The winners receive their prizes in ceremonies held on December 10th. I'm Ashley Thompson.
Teachers in many English classes across America are having students read fewer full-length books. Recently, the Associated Press explored the issue in education. It reports that students instead are given only short parts of books. Educators said this is because they believe current students have shorter attention spans than those of the past. The teachers might feel pressure to prepare students for state and nationwide examinations known as standardized tests. They also might believe that short pieces of writing will help students in the modern digital world. The National Council of Teachers of English is a professional organization for teachers based in Champaign, Illinois. In 2022, the group released a statement about reading. The time has come to decenter book reading and essay writing as the pinnacles of English language arts education, the group said.
Seth French helped write the statement. He said the idea was not to remove books, but to teach media literacy and have students read things in which they are interested. French taught an English class before becoming a dean at Bentonville High School in the state of Arkansas. He had students read plays, poetry, and articles, but only one book as a class. He said, "A lot of our students are not interested in some of these texts that they didn't have a choice in." Not everyone thinks English reading should only involve short, digital pieces of writing. Marianne Wolfe studies the human brain at UCLA in Southern California. Wolfe said Deep reading is important to strengthen connections in the brain tied to critical thinking skills, background knowledge, and empathy. She said educators must give students a chance to learn through what she described as immersion into the lives and thoughts of others.
There is not a lot of information on how many books American students are required to read in school, but in general, students are reading less. Federal data from last year shows 14% of young people said they read for fun every day. In 2012, that percentage was 27%. Some teachers say reduced reading has its roots in the COVID-19 crisis. Christy Acevedo teaches English at a vocational high school in New Bedford, Massachusetts. There was a trend, it happened when COVID hit, to stop reading full-length novels because students were in trauma. We were in a pandemic. The problem is we haven't quite come back from that, she said. Other teachers blame standardized testing and the influence of education technology. Some students struggle to read. Only one-third of fourth and eighth graders reached reading proficiency in the 2022 National Assessment of Educational Progress.
Leah Van Bell is the director of the nonprofit literacy coalition 313 Reads in Detroit, Michigan. Van Bell said when her son read the book Peter Pan in elementary school, it was too difficult for most children. She said her son's school does not have a library. Still, she said it makes sense for English classes to use shorter reading material. As an adult, if I want to learn about a topic and research it, be it personal or professional, I'm using interactive digital text to do that, she said. Even in schools with many resources, time is always in short supply. Terry White teaches at South Windsor High School in Connecticut. White no longer assigns the book To Kill a Mockingbird to her class. She assigns about one-third of the book and provides a synopsis, or a very short version, of the rest. White says the reason is that the class has to move quickly so she can teach all the required material. White also assigns less homework because students have sports and other activities. She said she wanted her class to be more about helping students become stronger and more critical readers, writers, and thinkers, while taking their social-emotional well-being into account.
The synopsis method alone, however, can harm student critical thinking skills, says Alden Jones, a literature professor at Emerson College in Boston, Massachusetts. Jones assigns fewer books than before, but gives more small tests to make sure students are reading. We don't value the thinking time that we used to have. It's all time we could be on our phone accomplishing tasks, she said. Will Higgins is an English teacher at Dartmouth High School in Massachusetts. Higgins said he still believes in teaching the classics, But he said students do not have enough time, so teachers have cut back on the number of books they teach. We haven't given up on Jane Eyre and Pride and Prejudice. We haven't given up on Hamlet or The Great Gatsby, he said. But Higgins admitted giving up on assigning a long book, like A Tale of Two Cities by Charles Dickens. I'm Mario Ritter, Jr.
And I'm Katie Weaver.
Just heard this week's education report, and Katie Weaver joins me now to talk more about the story. Hi, Katie. Thanks for being here.
Hello, Ashley. Thanks for inviting me to chat.
So I heard a word in this report that caught my attention, pinnacle. This means the highest point of something, right?
That's right. The top of something. Pinnacle has the same basic meaning as peak, and lots of other words. Summit also means top or highest point, as does acme and apex. You hear all those words a lot when you're talking about mountains.
In the report, however, a physical pinnacle is not under discussion. Here is the line. The time has come to decenter book reading and essay writing as the pinnacles of English language arts education.
Yes, here it is used to mean the highest point of curriculum development, or the best method of teaching reading or literature.
Okay, so I would think that some of the synonyms that you listed just a bit ago would not be great substitutes for pinnacle in that line from the report.
Exactly. It would sound funny to say book reading and essay writing are the summits of English language arts education, but the word peaks might work fine.
Okay. Well, thanks so much for coming on the show today, Katie. I'll talk with you soon.
Thank you, Ashley. It was fun.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com. Tomorrow, Brian Lynn presents this week's Learning English Technology Report. He takes a look at some new tools that Instagram is introducing to help protect young users. The changes include more controls for parents to improve safety and limit the amount of time their children spend on the social networking app. You can listen to Brian's report on tomorrow's podcast or by visiting our website, learningenglish.voanews.com.
Hello, my name is Anna Mateo.
My name is Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
You're listening to The Lesson of the Day on the Learning English Podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
Today we're going to talk about a sport some call America's sport. That's because in Lesson 31, Anna is trying to go to a baseball game.
Ah, so that's why Lesson 31 is called Take Me Out to the Ball Game.
I'm sure you know that song, Andrew. For our listeners, it's a song that they sing at the baseball parks during a short break in the play. People are encouraged to get up and stretch their legs while they sing the song.
Take me out to the ball game. Take me out to the park. I think one reason they started that is because baseball games can be long, sometimes 3 hours or longer.
You're probably right, Andrew, but things have changed. At the beginning of this year's season, they decided to use a new rule called the pitch timer. It makes the players move into place quickly and throw the ball or hit the ball within the set time. The games are now about a half hour shorter.
That's good news. Maybe I will go see a baseball game then. Let's see what Anna is doing in Lesson 31.
Hi there, sports fans. Baseball is America's sport. Today, I am going to Nationals Park. It is home to Washington, D.C.'s baseball team, the Washington Nationals. Hi, Jonathan.
Hi, Anna. Where are you going?
I am taking a bus to a Nationals baseball game.
Don't take the bus. A taxi is faster than a bus.
Oh, good idea. You know, I love baseball.
Oh, that's great. Have fun.
Anna says goodbye to Jonathan, but then runs into another friend on the street, Ashley. And she gives her some advice about getting to the ballpark. Remember, Jonathan told Anna,
"Don't take the bus. A taxi is faster than a bus."
But Ashley doesn't think that is such a good idea.
Hi, Anna.
Hi, Ashley.
Where are you going?
I am going to see a Nationals baseball game.
What time is the game?
7:00.
Do you have a ticket?
No, not yet.
Anna, you should go a lot earlier than 7:00.
That is why I'm taking a taxi. Taxi!
Anna, that is not a good idea. A bicycle is faster than a taxi.
Traffic is always a problem in Washington, D.C. But you learn some ways to get around, even when the streets are crowded. Ashley is telling Anna that she should go by bicycle to the ballpark.
That is a good idea. Bikes can ride around a line of cars. But I'm not sure Anna has a bike.
I don't think she does. And she tells Ashley,
"Oh, Ashley. Ashley. A car is faster than your bicycle."
That's why Ashley tells her,
"In DC traffic, sometimes a bicycle is faster than a car."
Did you notice her pronunciation there, Jill? I think this is another one of those reduced forms we always find in natural speech.
Yep, it is. Let's listen to how to pronounce host John Russell explain in our pronunciation practice video.
When English speakers use comparative adjectives, they sometimes do not pronounce the word than clearly. Ashley says,
In DC traffic, sometimes a bicycle is faster than a car.
So you may hear someone say,
"The metro is faster than a taxi."
There, you hear a reduced vowel, the schwa, instead of the sound, a. Listen. Van. Then. You know, we could give some examples with some other adjectives to compare ways to get to the baseball park.
Oh, like riding a bicycle is cheaper than taking the metro.
And taking the metro is cheaper than taking a taxi. Notice also, we use the verb take with both taxi and metro, but we say ride with bike.
And of course we use drive if we are driving a car. In lesson 31, Ashley tries to lend Anna her bike. She soon learns that Anna can't ride a bike. Let's listen to that part.
In DC traffic, sometimes a bicycle is faster than a car. And right now, there is a lot of traffic.
Good point. But I don't have a bicycle.
Okay, Anna. You can use my bicycle.
Thanks!
Oh!
I really want to learn how to ride one!
Well, what do you mean, learn how to ride a bike? Oh, Anna! Anna!
Well, it looks like Anna is going to have to find another way to get to the game.
Let's finish the lesson and see how she gets there.
You know, Anna, the metro is faster than a taxi and a bicycle. You ought to take the metro. It's that way.
Good idea.
Okay.
See you later.
Bye, Anna.
Bye. The metro was a lot faster than a bus, taxi, or bike. And now I'm at National Park.
This might be a good chance for our listeners to practice their pronunciation by talking about two means or two ways of transportation in their own town or city. Pick a place you want to go and tell us about the different ways you can get there.
Send us an email at learningenglish@voanews.com or write your comment on our YouTube video.
And remember that there are dozens of episodes of the Let's Learn English series you can watch to help you learn English. And don't forget, on our website, learningenglish.voanews.com, each episode of the Let's Learn English series comes with a lesson plan you can download to help you learn more or even teach English to others.
Thanks for listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English Podcast. I'm Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
That's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.